We have to use this internet connection. Thank you for this chance to participate in the conference. I'm going to speak about cervical cancer, HPV tumors. Of course, will be under discussion. This problem in the Russian Federation is very topical. You can see that incidence is high, 17,500 women, more than 6,000 die of this malignant tumor. And as Paul mentioned, it's oncogenic types of HPV contribute considerably into development of such cancer, type 16 and 18. First of all, in Russia and all over the world, regretfully, basic layer of this pyramid looks very sadly. We have here data from the Russian Federation published in 2017-2019, incidence of cervical cancer associated with HPV. Other HPV-associated tumors exist as well. They were named today. They are topical as well, and they impact the quality of life and the survival, life expectancy, and HPV-associated tumors of uterine, for example. They participate in head and neck, anal tumors, and penile cancer. All of them contribute. The figure from the statistical point of view looks not very impressive, but it's obvious that the problem is very topical, and regretfully, when the situation is detected late, the prognosis is very sad. And all in all, HPV-associated tumors are here, men and women, more than 27,000 people in Russia. As Paul mentioned, women have screening, prevention, cervical prevention, but in Russian Federation, we can't say that it is perfectly organized. We have orders, we have documents for obstetricians, for gynecologists, for professional screening, provided that this woman will come, will see the doctor. There is an order from 2019, so such examination should be done with a cytological screening 1 to 3 years between 18 and 64 years old. But all over the world, the tendency is more profound, let's say. HPV testing as secondary prevention, as to be able to find it at reinvasion forms. For Russian Federation, this is very critical. We do not have any coordinating center which would be responsible for screening. We think how to improve the situation in the Russian Federation. Organized screening programs are needed. It depends on organizers of our health system, actually, and how to introduce this, how to inform through mass media, how to disseminate information in a better way. The WHO, secondary one, screening, cytological or HPV screening, is necessary, it's recommended. It's in the guidelines, but at the same time, vaccination is recommended by WHO primary prevention that can reduce the incidence of cervical cancer. Same guidelines were given from there. Other societies like European Society of Gynecologists as early as in 2007, they recommended the screening and primary prevention was recommended, but they recommend secondary primary immunization and then screening. So secondary screening was demonstrated as a result of organized screening. Its positive effects were demonstrated in America, in Canada. Whether it's cytological screening or HPV screening, I must say that in Finland they have minimal levels of disease of cervical cancer because now they provide screening very broadly. Now they introduce HPV screening, so they managed to organize it perfectly, and they introduced HPV screening in addition to screening. The incidence is very low. And of course, in other countries, much attention should be taken, should be applied. Vaccines are very topical. Type 6/11 should be added, not only 16/18 against them, because together in oncogenic situation it could give very bad results. Immunization is necessary in accordance with recommendations 3 times from 9 up to 45 years old with adequate interruptions. And recently it was shown that 2 immunizations are could be adopted in 9 to 13 years, but the second jet should be done in half a year. Then we'll provide necessary level of antibodies, then we'll achieve good prevention among young girls and boys. This is preventional vaccine for those who are not sexually active, and of course 2 times, 2 sessions are acceptable. It's about saving money as well. We see countries where it was introduced. In some countries, it is given to children while they are in school. In Denmark and Italy, when children are in organized teams, and pediatricians could provide good coverage. In the United States, it is being done not by pediatricians, but by general practitioners. So the coverage is lower because of this. But we should say that in Russia, we are in gray color here. Regretfully, vaccination against papilloma is not introduced in the national calendar. Though its effect, its efficacy was demonstrated as a result of the clinical studies, multi-central ones like this one. It's a very big cohort included, and if its efficacy was demonstrated, its prevention against HPV, its prevention against this plastic changes on their cervix. Do we need revaccination? For how long does it protect? We discussed the levels of antibodies, considered its efficacy, but we are more interested in prevention of dysplastic changes in the cervix. It was proved. Experience of different countries that introduced this vaccine in the national calendar. Even during 12 years of follow-up, it protects against development of pre-invasive cervix diseases in the group of women 16 to 26 years, for example. I would like to repeat that women could be vaccinated up to 45 years, and it provides protection against pre-cancer disease of cervix. Protection about genital papillomas as well is provided. Who were the pioneers that introduced immunization in their population broadly? Australia, first of all, then US, where the results are not that impressive, but the comparison of people who were infected by HPV before immunization, century and after, very impressive results were got, not regarding 18th and 16th, but 11 and 6 as well, demonstrated a reduction of levels. How could we say whether it works or not? It was demonstrated that it works. Our Australian colleagues demonstrated it when they compared candylomas, their prevalence before introduction of immunization and after. You can see almost 100% of candylomas prevalence, cervical dysplasia, precancer, changes, non-invasive, but dysplasia, serious dysplasia, which is threatening with invasive process. It was demonstrated as well, reduction of incidence before vaccination and after vaccination. The situations were compared, situation in the United States. We can see reduction of the prevalence of HPV. It's obvious in comparison with the era before and after vaccination. Another thing I would like to dwell about, it's I have just heard in news at a conference of gynecologists how to protect how this vaccine could protect against recurrence of dysplasia.
We should not be using the prophylactic vaccine as therapeutic one, but this particular aspect has always been of interest to me as clinicians, because first, from the beginning of the 21st century, we spoke about the use of prophylactic or preventative vaccines, which actually for women who got infected with HPV, and there is persistence, there is dysplasia of the cervix, and it got detected in the pre-invasive stage, and there is surgical correction performed. So here, such type of treatment, the efficacy can reach up to 94%. The only aspect, and this mainly is relevant to young women, these are 6% when we have a risk of relapse. That means reinfection. The idea actually is that they are treated and the dysplasia is rid of, and there is elimination of the HPV. So the patients become actually HPV naive. And as a matter of fact, here, maybe this preventative vaccine might help this particular cohort of women not to reinfect with HPV, just like in this situation when a young patient, 32 years of age, who where the colonization of the cervix was performed, and she even gave birth, and after that there was a relapse of the HPV of CA in situ, and in the cytological monitoring after 3 years there is a tumor, and as exophyte tumor, squamous cell, cervical carcinoma, radical hysterectomy was performed. Actually, there was radical treatment performed to this woman, and there was a radical surgical treatment, and in fact, we could have avoided relapse here. This is our Caribbean colleagues who put this question forward for the first time. Not very long ago, we received the result of this meta-analysis from America and Europe, where it was clearly demonstrated that the preventative vaccine is quite effective for this cohort of patients. It works preventatively and protects from reinfection with HPV in the HPV-naive woman. And it was demonstrated indeed that we can mitigate the risk of relapsing in these women who were just vaccinated preventatively. So you can see bivalent and quadrivalent vaccines were used, and they were vaccinated immediately after surgical colonization. And as the vaccination actually was triple, then there were used different variants of vaccines. But nonetheless, we have double reduction in the risk of relapsing, which once again clinically stresses that the vaccine is has quite good protective action against the HPV, and to a certain extent, it allows us to answer the question whether women who are sexually active, whether they need to get the vaccine. Yes, indeed, the effect will be lower, because if there is HPV infection already, it will not actually be a cure from the already existent infection, but actually it will protect from reinfection or superinfection with other types. Now, coming to the conclusion of my talk, I should say that there are a lot of positive regulatory guidelines telling us about the safety and efficacy of Gardasil, and they remain such since 2014, since even earlier period, like FDA started recommending it starting from 2009. And the International Federation of Gynecologists and Obstetricians recommended starting from the 2013. In Russia, we don't have any national program of vaccination against HPV and no mass coverage with screening programs. Nonetheless, I suppose that such opportunity is in our hands. It does exist, and our task is to inform our patients, to raise the awareness of our colleagues and our patients, and actually improve the coverage with vaccination and the